Okay, yes.
Dr. Sars, I want to ask a question related to the question that you got into some hot water about before. I'm a psychiatrist. I run an office psychotherapeutic practice, and I don't have a secretary that takes bookings either. And I talk to people before they get in the door, and it's bloody hard to get into my door. I'm interested to hear what you do when somebody rings you up and tells and wants to see you and tells you that they feel suicidal. This relates to the issue of, I mean, you said before, you know, if you feel suicidal, why are you coming to a psychiatrist's office? Why aren't you jumping off the top of the Hilton? And I am interested to hear what your response to those sorts of issues are. I mean, what in fact you feel are the rights and privileges of those people who want to kill themselves?
Oh, I thought you were going to... I really hear two questions there. Maybe I should... I'll answer the question you asked in a moment. Actually, if somebody calls me up, I was being facetious and facile and humorous and wanted to make a point. Obviously, if somebody calls me up and in some ways talks about suicide and depression, I will assume that they want to talk to me, or else they would already be dead. So in point of fact, I would probably give them an appointment, and we would then be discussing life and death and suicide. But I would try to discuss suicide with the same earnestness and sincerity and dispassion as I would divorce or marriage or having a child. You know, I would not get specially, you know, it's not very desirable. You can only do it once if you do it right, but, you know.
No. Dr. Zaz,
Excuse me. What can you restate? What is the second question that you really want to know?
We are talking, in a sense, about the rights and privileges of adults, and I'd like to hear your views about the rights and privileges of people wishing to kill themselves.
I am working on a book on that. I really am. See, that Camus said that there is only one philosophical question, and that's suicide.
That's right.
Well, I think that's an overstatement, but it's a very elegant one, a very good one.
Yes,
that's a very, very good question you're asking, because you see, it isn't just rights and privileges, but what are the rights and privileges of other people in society who depend on other people? And we are now not just talking about rights and privileges, we are talking about the problem of something being, we are talking about a borderline that we have been dancing around and which psychiatry does terrible injustice to, namely, in what way, at what point, does society collectively decide to make something immoral, illegal, or vice versa? That is, as I hear your question.
That's and Jasper's most famous patient, or most famous written-up patient, in fact, suicided, and was considered a successful case of treatment.
Now, that is abortion in some ways is a case in point. You know, is it moral? Is it immoral? If somebody says it's immoral, should it also be illegal? I would certainly separate very sharply to answer your question now. I could obviously have thought of this all my life, and this is where I now stand. It's my position now. I believe that, and I'm speaking about adults, that under no circumstances should a civilized, free society empower anyone to incarcerate or restrain anyone forcibly from committing suicide. So, actually, I'm having a paper published called The Case Against Suicide Prevention, which is exactly what it's about, which, by the way, speaking of censorship, the American Psychiatric Association Journal, of course, rejected, although it was originally presented in a symposium, it will be published in the American Psychologist this summer. Thank you to the psychologist. I'm going to spend the rest of the time on this question. Please, everybody, sit down, because this is too important. Yes, but you see, suicide is a very interesting question, because suicide, more than most other acts, is very upsetting to people. If you like, it's a little bit like public sex or something like that. Now, there's nothing, my favorite example is, there's nothing wrong with a husband and wife having intercourse with each other, but you can't do it right here, or in the lobby, or in the middle of the street. Now, similarly, I think that a civilized society should have laws which seriously punish people who commit suicide under circumstances which interfere with other people's life, liberty, and property. So that if you get up on the Triborough Bridge and hold up traffic and cause $200,000 worth of damage to people, and then don't do it, and they fish you down, I would sentence that person to 5 years of hard labor and let him commit suicide in jail if he wants to. In other words, you should be able to commit suicide, just like you should be able to smoke or take heroin on your own turf. And we haven't gotten to that. It seems to me the issue is not just of what can you do in a civilized society, but where can you do it? And we haven't even touched that. There are a lot of things which are not particularly good, but which should be allowable in private. And by private, I mean you do it privately, and also it doesn't have public consequences. And this relates to drinking. I mean, you talk about dangerousness and psychiatrists. What about smoke? What about drunken driving? I mean, that's one of the greatest obscenities in America. And some of the most famous people in America are drunk drivers who have never been punished for it. In the public eye.